Welcome to There's Sometimes Un Camion, your responsible opinions about classic film. I'm Elise.
I'm Dave. This week it's the Hollywood Studios, year by year, Warner Brothers 1946. We've got a pair of rather fabulistic biopics for you, Night and Day and Devotion.
You might say whitewashed.
More than that, just completely made up. I think, but we'll see how that works out for aesthetic value.
Spoilers!
After we discuss those films, we've got a particularly full Fear and Moviegoing in Toronto episode for you. We saw 5 Marguerite Duras films, part of an ongoing retrospective at the TIFF Lightbox. Détruire, dit-elle, India Song, La Femme du Gange, Son nom de Venise dans Calcutta Désert, and Le Camion.
Which means truck.
Elise is really going with that one.
We also need to make a note.
For posterity.
Well, no, just for listeners, for contemporary listeners and future listeners and any listeners, that we have moved.
We're above ground.
From our basement residential area to not exactly a high rise, but a more elevated location. That's also in a more urban area of downtown Toronto. So you may hear some urban character, some color.
There may be some sirens. There's definitely some construction going on Yonge Street below our window.
Below our bedroom window.
So we'll see what we can do about keeping that noise under control, but I don't think that we're going to have anything like the airtight vacuum that we used to have.
Which was very noisy for us, actually, but not as noisy for you, since the noise removal took it out very neatly. We're not sure how exactly that's going to work now.
Yeah, the HVAC was quite loud in our basement, but yeah, it was consistent. So yeah, the program had no trouble taking it out. We'll see how this goes. We are undaunted, and we hope that you are as well, and we're going to dive right in. We'll begin, as we always do, with Joel W. Findler's The Hollywood Story. He's got a list or a chart of the important players in his mind at each studio in each year. He gives them a ranking of 1, 2, or 3 stars, and sometimes we understand why he does it, other times we don't. But let's get into it for Warner Brothers in 1946. Ida Lupino, 2 stars. Paul Henri, 2 stars, both relevant to our episode this week. Betty Davis, 3 stars, a stalwart of the studio. Peter Lorre, 1 star.
Sad, not warranted.
Sidney Greenstreet, 1 star.
Also sad.
Eleanor Parker, 2 stars. Humphrey Bogart, 3 stars. Joan Crawford, 3 stars. Lauren Bacall, 2 stars. Errol Flynn, 3 stars. Claude Rains, 2 stars. Anne Sheridan, 2 stars. Jane Wyman, 2 stars. Ronald Reagan, back from the war, 2 stars.
More than Peter Lorre. That's just uncalled for.
So that's what we've got at Warner Brothers in 1946. Now let's pass on to Clive Hirshhorn and his The Warner Brothers Story. What did he have to say about Devotion?
Oh dear.
Completed nearly 3 years before its release, Devotion was an absurdly romanticized biography of the Brontë sisters, which, in many instances, turned fact into fiction.
Okay, but hold it right there. I don't think the problem is romanticization. If anyone knows the actual story of the Brontë family, you couldn't romanticize it more than it actually was.
We'll get into that, I'm sure. It starred Ida Lupino. Oh, well, right here. Okay, this guy doesn't know anything, and we're probably going to have to disregard this review, but let's continue.
You're so mad.
It starred Ida Lupino as Charlotte.
Okay, well, yeah.
Olivia de Havilland as Emily. No. And Nancy Coleman as the youngest sister, Anne.
Did that make him very confused when he was watching it?
I guess. I don't know. Joan Fontaine, de Havilland's sister, was originally sought for the Lupino role, but her much-publicized feud with Olivia ruled out any possibility of their teaming up. Also, because of Miss de Havilland's recalcitrant behavior towards the studio and her virulent criticisms of its policies, She was given third billing below Lupino and Paul Henried in the publicity campaign.
Did you just say Joan Fontaine was supposed to play Emily Brontë?
Or Charlotte or whatever, since this guy doesn't know what he's talking about. Henried was miscast as the Reverend Nichols, the Irish-born curate, and the fabricated object of both Emily's and Charlotte's romantic yearnings. I mean, he was Charlotte's husband, wasn't he?
Yes, and also, but other than that, yeah, it's a bit of a stretch. Paul Henried is an Irish curate.
The best performance in an otherwise bogus film was by Arthur Kennedy as the tormented brother Branwell. Keith Winter's screenplay refused to acknowledge that the unadorned facts were more dramatic than anything that emerged from his imagination. Curtis Bernhardt directed as if it were no more than pulp fiction, which, in the circumstances, it was. Also cast were Dame Mae Whitty and Victor Franken. Eric Wolfgang Korngold wrote the score. Robert Buckner produced.
For once, I have sympathy with Bosley Crowther's take. More sympathy, anyway, than with that take. The Warners have simplified matters to an almost irreducible extreme, and have found an explanation for the Brontës in Louisa May Alcott terms. They have visioned Sombrous Emily, the author of Wuthering Heights, and Charlotte, the writer of Jane Eyre, as a couple of little women with a gift, he also said of it, called it a mawkish costume romance, even with identities removed, presented as the story of the Brontës, and with the secondary characters poorly played. It is a ridiculous tax upon reason, and an insult to plain intelligence. Yeah, pretty much. Although, I didn't think the secondary characters were poorly played.
No, nor did I. And in fact, I really enjoyed watching this movie.
But he's right. I mean, this does make more sense as like a take on Little Women.
Sure. Emily is Jo and Charlotte is Meg.
Charlotte is also Jo. Charlotte is the one who realizes her ambitions as a writer. Well, I mean, they all do. Other than poor Branwell.
Right. Well, no one talks about Anne writing any novels, but she did.
She did. But nobody cared. The narrator at the beginning says that
two of them have genius.
Two of them have genius. And I wondered if we were supposed to wonder who that was for a while. I wondered if we were actually supposed to think maybe Branwell was one, but I didn't really understand. With the Brontës, there's this weird little bubble of gender role reversal in the reception, where Branwell has just been held in utter contempt. There's been some revisionism on that, apparently, in recent years, or I don't know when exactly, but there has been some revisionism, according to the little bit of Google research I did. But no, he was just considered an absolutely pathetic loser in Brontë's studies.
Yeah.
So I think we are supposed to, from the beginning, know that the ones with genius are Emily and Charlotte.
Seems a reasonable assumption, yeah. The movie was sold on the basis of it being a biopic of the Brontës, so they were expecting people to know at least Jane Eyre and Wuthering Heights, which had been adapted into Hollywood films within, you know, a few years of the making of this film.
In contrast to Hirshhorn, I thought the best performances were Ida Lupino and Olivia de Havilland, particularly in their scenes together. And once you put aside worrying about this as a depiction of the Brontës, that it was a kind of interesting sister drama, particularly in the 30s, to some degree, in some cases, because of the pro-working class bias of Warner Brothers. The studio committed some crimes against gender. Depictions of grasping platinum blonde ex-wives. But often the studio was doing things with gender that really no one else was trying to do, or other than RKO with Katharine Hepburn, right? And this seems like a fair example of that.
I agree. I think laying my cards on the table, I mean, yes, both of these movies are travesties of their biographical subjects, but this one I really enjoyed watching on the face of it. It was really entertaining. The performances are great, I think, at least a couple of them. I was thoroughly transported and able to forget who they were supposed to be.
Which is the best way to approach it.
Night and day is another matter. We'll talk about that.
Yes, I do feel that there is a distinction in quality, intrinsic cinematic quality or narrative quality between the two movies we watched this week.
This is a great opportunity for Ida Lupino. And again, yes, she's not playing Emily Brontë the way we probably have come to understand that historical person.
Nor can you for a moment imagine Olivia de Havilland, Charlotte Brontë, as the woman who wrote Villette, which is one of the most depressing, existentially despairing novels I have ever read. And you wouldn't know from the ending that in real life, Charlotte Brontë only lived 9 months after her marriage, which took place well after Emily's death.
Yeah, that's right.
And died in childbirth, as if the deaths of so many of their family members had not already in advance justified the despair of Villette. Her own ending did. Not even childbirth, apparently. Horrible complication of pregnancy involving vomiting.
Oh, geez. Yeah, the longest lived of the Brontë sisters made it to what, 37, 38?
Well, like the Brontës at all. Yeah. The Brontë siblings.
Well, the Brontë dad seems to have gone on and on. And Arthur Nichols, right? Didn't he live into the 20th century?
Let's talk about some of the background here that you can't even imagine taking place in this movie. So Emily was the second youngest of six siblings, preceded by Maria, Elizabeth, Charlotte, and Branwell. So the mother died when all six children were under the age of 8. They were then to be cared for by the aunt, Elizabeth, who does appear in the movie. The eldest two sisters, Maria and Elizabeth, died when the remaining children were under 10 years of age. And, you know, they just kept dying after that.
Well, I don't think that's terribly unusual for the 19th century.
Not terribly unusual, but a pretty big death toll for one family.
Wears on you. I mean, even if it is common, it's still gonna damage your psyche.
Let's see, how old was Charlotte when she died? She lived to a ripe old age. 38, and to be pregnant at 38 at that time. And then the other stuff that you don't really get any sense of from the movie is that all of these children, the surviving children, grew up inventing elaborate fantasy worlds that they also made into narratives together, including Branwell.
Emily, I thought she was the main force behind that, and she and Anne were the ones that played around with the
it was everybody.
Tolkien world that they created.
It was everybody, apparently.
Okay.
The Branwell and Charlotte world was called, well, one of them was called Angria.
Okay.
Which is suitable for the kind of fiction that the geniuses ended up producing anyway.
What's the Emily one? Gondoril or something?
Gondol.
Gondol. Okay.
Was another one. I don't know which worlds belong to whom exactly. Apparently Charlotte and Branwell worked together a lot. That could provide a fascinating background to the relationships we see in this movie, but it's not even hinted at. They really don't consistently give us any sense of some private world being occupied by these siblings.
There's a gesture toward it, but you're right. It does veer away from that by the second half of the movie, and it becomes more about the conflict between Emily and Charlotte.
At that point, let's just abandon altogether any ties to the real characters and the real people and just talk about what the movie is doing. The movie has decided to make a contrast between Charlotte as this ambitious and practical and popular author who thinks about how to get along in the world and knows how to do it and knows how to charm people and has some kind of social ability, and Emily as someone who's existing off on her own, in her own fantasy land, and is never going to be able to make that connection with the real world, but is all the greater a genius for it.
To me, it seems fairly clear that what they decided to do was perform a kind of a gloss on Wuthering Heights, split Kathy into two. Emily Brontë becomes the Kathy that has, you know, the fierce integrity at Penistone Crag, and Charlotte becomes the Kathy that wants to go live with the Lintons.
I hadn't thought of that at all, but sure, you can look at it that way.
And we just watched Wuthering Heights, of course, and thought about it a little, so that was fresh in my mind.
And we also made an equivalence that would work here again with Ghost World if Scarlett Johansson was Charlotte.
You know, just based on the script as delivered to us, that the creators think Wuthering Heights is a far superior book. Sidney Greenstreet tells us that as Thackeray. Of course, it's not popular, but its greatness will become all the more apparent in the decades and centuries ahead. Now, Charlotte partisans may have objected to that, may still object to that if they care to watch this film.
I think it's a pretty commonly held opinion, though. I didn't actually look into the reception history of the two novels and whether Wuthering Heights developed this reputation after modernism?
Well, it can only have grown during successive waves of avant-gardism, because
right,
it's doing all kinds of things that are going to appeal to people that want to look for the new, you know, unprecedentedly intense in a number of ways. The themes in Wuthering Heights and just the structure of it is so intricate and extraordinary.
That's true. That said, Charlotte is not a walk in the park, even in Jane Eyre, let alone in, as I was saying, Villette.
No, it's true.
Which pretty much broke my mind when I read it.
Yeah, I don't think there's any reason that we have to pit them against each other that way.
And the hilarity is that these books, because their romance is in two senses, right? They have a romance at the center of them, and they are also romantic, fantastical, to some degree, particularly Wuthering Heights. These have been sold as books that are suitable for young teenage girls to read, which is when I first read them, when I was 12.
Right.
Who are the last people on Earth placed to understand these novels. Particularly, again, Wuthering Heights.
I think we're agreed in saying that we do not have to, as literary critics, oppose Charlotte and Emily in any kind of a schematic way. But it does work well for a drama to have them be opposed in this way.
What's more insulting is having them compete for the same man, or not compete, but be in conflict over the same man.
I mean, Emily doesn't fight for Arthur Nichols. She supposedly falls in love with him. They have their brief time together walking on the moors. It seems like he understands her.
And who would fight for this man? Like, this is Paul Henri. Wow, what a thankless role for Paul Henri.
I always like Paul Henri. He's a welcome presence in any film. I don't know if he needs to be scourged.
Oh, and the idea, even more insulting than having them have this angst over this man, is the idea that he could possibly be the basis for either Rochester or particularly Heathcliff.
No, he's pretty mild-mannered.
It's absurd. Or the real-life Reverend Nichols? Worse! Because he was not played by Paul Henri.
Yeah, I'm not sure exactly how understanding Wuthering Heights would help you to understand that Emily Brontë was in love with Paul Henri in this movie. But that is what we're asked to believe by the end. It does lead to Charlotte's epiphany.
Maybe he was Kathy.
Yeah, possibly. I don't know. We should delve into the role that Arthur Kennedy's Branwell plays in the film, because he is kind of the linchpin. A lot of the conflict between Emily and Charlotte, certainly at the beginning, it's not about how to write or how to be in the world. It's about how to position Branwell to get ahead or survive.
Right, so this seemed very unusual, and here the film is using the biography or the legend that formed around the Brontë siblings to do some pretty unusual stuff for the time with gender, to do this critique of women of talent or better sacrificing or undermining themselves for a worthless male just because he is male. There are also bonds of love there.
Yeah, very strong bonds of love, and I think the movie does a decent job of communicating the fact that Branwell understands at some level that he is not worth the sacrifices his sisters are making, and this is exacerbating his drunkenness.
And he's possibly also tormented himself because he has to creatively compete with all of these women who are worthy rivals and can't just grasp the privilege that he thinks ought to be his by birthright, by right of being male. That itself may be thwarting him from fulfilling whatever talent he has.
Yeah, exactly. And Arthur Kennedy does a great job of playing this character, I think. I mean, there are mysteries there. There are things that we'll never get to the bottom of. But he communicates that. I mean, we've seen a lot of films with Arthur Kennedy, mostly from the 50s, where he really came into his own as a powerhouse. But here we could see the junior version of that, and he acquits himself extremely well. Because it's not easy to play a character that's this sneering and this much of an obstacle to everyone else, and this still make him believably lovable to these sisters.
And this vicious. He is like a hysterical, thwarted woman, right? Who's been thwarted from fulfilling her talent by being overlooked in favor of men, except this role reversal has occurred. And he acts out more than such a woman typically would. Such a woman might use a shrewish tongue to take things out on people. Well, he does that, but he also jumps on horses and tries to crash carriages and makes scenes in pubs.
Yeah, well, he's got the power and the freedom to go to a pub and get drunk and not be completely banished. A woman that did that in those circles in the 1840s would be just gone.
Now, interestingly, the real Branwell, I don't know if you knew this, according to some sources, only steeply declined after a failed love affair with a much older married woman who, after her husband died, refused to marry him.
Oh. No, I don't know much about the real Brontes, honestly.
No, neither do I. I just, you know, I was looking through some materials while researching this episode, and that's one of the things I came across, which would have been very interesting and strange to portray in this movie. Very strange for a movie of the time.
That would have been too much, I think. The movie has taken on quite a bit as is, because there's all the stuff in Yorkshire, there's all the stuff in Belgium, there's Charlotte's adventure at Vanity Fair in London.
Now, what's useful about having Ida Lupino play Emily Brontë? Well, of course, Ida Lupino, future director, who, when called upon, and most recently, we talked about this quality of hers, I think, in the Monty Woolley movie, Life Begins at 8:30. When called upon, will very quietly and uncompromisingly portray a character who is psychologically complicated, intelligent, and sort of unapologetically quietly intense.
Yeah.
And that's how she plays this character.
One caricature, possibly based in reality, of Emily Brontë is that she's this elemental figure that is running around the moors all the time and cannot interface with the social world in any way. That's not how Ida Lupino plays her. She plays her just as a mystic kind of introvert.
Yeah.
Which is, I think, a really wonderful characterization to see in a film. You don't get characters like this very often, and it may very well be a departure from the biographical Emily Brontë, but worthwhile in its own right, I think.
She's a mystic introvert, but she is also very level-headed and clear-sighted.
Yeah.
More so than Charlotte, who can function in that way very well in the social world, but within her own family has a tendency to be a little bit silly.
Yeah, they've really developed that kind of dynamic.
So it's Emily who initially has the clearer view of, for example, Branwell's role in the family and what would and would not be good for him and what he's doing to them all.
And she does seem to be the one that loves Branwell the most. And she gets the biggest scene with him, cradling him as he dies.
Something I did see in looking up Emily's biography is that one of her teachers at the various schools that the girls attended said that she should have been a man because she had an extraordinary gift for logic. That might accord with Ida Lupino's characterization, her cool and level-headed mystic.
Right. Well, maybe there's more truth in this film than we're giving it credit for. But one thing that does sort of activate the plot, and I guess you can make of that what you will, whether it's a good thing or not, is Paul-Henri Reed's arrival as the curate. He is initially not welcomed by the elderly Papa Brontë, but he ingratiates himself there. Everyone likes him. It becomes sort of like the Four Daughters almost, right? With Geoffrey Lynn showing up and people want him to just stay forever, and he kind of does, and he's adopted by all the daughters as well. Even Branwell likes him. He helps Branwell out of a tough scrape a couple of occasions.
And also punches him on another one.
But Branwell acknowledges that that's what had to be done. I had to be punched at that time. Which are the nice little admissions that Arthur Kennedy will make that keep him sympathetic.
I don't know. I just found him endlessly obnoxious, despite those moments. I did not see it coming that Paul-Henri Reed was in love with Olivia de Havilland.
The movie is relying very strongly on the fact that Olivia de Havilland is just so unbelievably good looking.
I find Ida Lupino unbelievably good looking.
They're both very attractive, but Olivia de Havilland is in another stratosphere, and that's kind of...
No, I find Ida Lupino much more attractive.
Okay, well, that's not how the movie portrays them. Of course, it's bound up with gender norms.
Well, I was wondering if the moment that he decided that he couldn't possibly have sex with this woman is when she started talking about how she believes in ghosts.
That's part of it, too. He's interested in her, he thinks that she's very intelligent, he likes talking to her, but yeah, she's just a little bit too out there for him. But also, the movie dwells on him just his jaw dropping when he sees Olivia de Havilland.
See, I don't have that reaction to Olivia de Havilland. So.
But he does in the movie.
Well, I didn't even notice.
He definitely does. I don't think this has anything to do with what Charlotte Brontë looked like and what Emily Brontë looked like.
Speaking of which, you know the famous picture of the three sisters, Emily, Charlotte, and Anne, done by Branwell. Apparently, I didn't know this, or if I knew it, I forgot it. The weird color strip in the background of that painting is that he had painted himself in it. And then decided he didn't like his portrait and painted himself out. Holy shit.
Well, there you have it in a nutshell. The movie is very clear when Olivia de Havilland and Paul Henri meet that, yeah, he's forgotten about Emily.
Okay.
For whatever reason. Most of it, I think, has to do with...
his balls being shriveled by his intimidation.
The way Ida Lupino plays it, she gives up immediately. She realizes her love can't be returned.
I don't think Olivia de Havilland could ever play a character half as sexy as Ida Lupino's in Roadhouse.
I'm just talking about the way Hollywood deployed Olivia de Havilland at the time.
Except in Gone with the Wind.
Well, that's true.
And this is much later.
And Strawberry Blonde, I mean, she plays... somehow the less glamorous option in that film.
Yeah, exactly. That's why I wasn't necessarily expecting this to be the case. But, I mean, she looks great. At a certain point, it settles into this movie that's about the contrast between the two girls, highlighted when they're sent away by the secret auspices of Paul Henri's character.
Right, so he contrives to buy one of Branwell's paintings on the assurance that the, I guess, most of the proceeds, or all of it, will go to sending the two eldest Brontës away. Emily doesn't want to go. She makes this one last plea to Paul Henri. Do I have any reason to stay as far as you're concerned? He's like, no, sorry.
Yeah, and also Olivia de Havilland isn't interested in him.
Well, no. I mean, he kisses her. He's seized by this urge to kiss her as soon as he sees her, but she thinks it's just something that he maybe does all the time.
Her mind is full of fancies.
She doesn't believe that this is a deep love. She's offended by his attention.
Well, she keeps talking about how, I mean, one of the ways in which the contrast between the girls is presented is that she keeps talking about how she wants to go out in the world and live a full and rich life and get a full education so that she will be able to write about it. And then this is contrasted with Emily, whose inner world provides her with more than enough material. Part of this is that Charlotte wants to have experiences and thinks she has to go out into the wider world and meet foreigners in order to do that once they are away at this school in Belgium.
That's where they meet Victor Franken, who is the professor that recognizes their intellectual abilities and seems to be quite taken with Charlotte, and he knows that she has a crush on him. And he decides to exploit that and teach her a lesson. That's the way the movie puts it anyway, when they go into the tunnel of love or whatever it's called.
Well, I thought this was an interesting way of portraying this sort of flirtation. She has this crush on her professor. It is reciprocated. His wife seems to be the headmistress, right?
Yeah.
They seem to be running this school together. And his wife knows about these, well, we find out by the end that his wife knows about these flirtations. The movie doesn't present them as going any further than that. The wife, I just love that little moment between the husband and wife, which is the last we see of them after Charlotte has made her embarrassing declaration that she and the professor are in love, and it's just, you know, dismissed without even any anger or irritation by the wife. Really? Because she thinks he's been an idiot to play with the affections of a girl who's talented enough to be really fanciful about it, right? Who's going to take it too seriously or too far. But from his perspective, as you said, he is teaching her a lesson because, you know, she's just, according to the movie, she's just this bourgeois girl from a backwater and has these romantic notions that she's going to have this great passion and this great life experience, but she's not really capable of going through with that.
No, she's Ruth Chatterton in Dodsworth.
Sure.
To allude to our discussion last week.
Except much younger.
Sure, of course.
Ruth Chatterton does go through with it, but it starts destroying her Daisy Miller style.
Yeah, it takes her a while. This is more like the way she behaved with David Niven.
And it's that experience that leads her to have a conversation with Emily about Paul and Reed, and Emily suggests in the course of the conversation that Paul and Reed might be in love with her, and this now that she's had her bubble burst and her bluff called, realizes that she doesn't really want to have all these wild experiences. The idea of someone actually being in love with her is appealing.
So, sadly, Emily Brontë is put in the position of having to play Cupid for her sister and the man that she will love for the rest of her very short life.
And all of this is, like, fucking stupid. But it ultimately leads to some good things, because once Thackeray appears on the scene and plays a more beneficent pedagogical role in Charlotte's life.
I think Sydney Greenstreet is really fun in this movie.
Very fun, yeah. Eventually Charlotte comes to understand her youthful silliness and self-centeredness, to see past it to quiet Emily, right? And once that happens, the women, the actresses, get some very good scenes together. It's ultimately about these two geniuses of very different temperament, who also love each other as sisters, coming to this mutual understanding. Greater, obviously, than their difference over this man.
Right, and the great thing about their scenes in the latter half of the film, very few of them deal with talk of romance at all, right? It really is about a philosophy of life and a viewpoint. They do pass the Bechdel test in some of those discussions that are so poignant and really make the film worth watching. Some of them are motivated by the fact that they're in love with the same man, but they hardly talk about that. Instead, they're talking about how a human being behaves, how an artist behaves, and what they see in the world. And now, again, the movie is very pro-Emily, pro-Wuthering Heights, so it's making it more about how Charlotte has to learn to hold to the core of integrity that for her is represented by Emily, right, as an artist and as a human being. Almost none of that is about being in love with Paul-Henri.
And yeah, it's interesting because Emily is presented as this mystic and visionary, very different from how we were talking about the author of Wuthering Heights as a purely antisocial black humorist in our Goldwyn episode. Both are true, right? But in this movie, this mystic visionary character is presented as someone angelic, and actually I think the term is used about her. And Ida Lupino's strange and fey kind of beauty works very well for that, right?
Oh, I agree.
Which, oddly enough, can be used in a very sexual way in Roadhouse, and I don't fully understand that, but it works, because she's a very good actor. But yeah, as you say, because of that, Emily does become this, as another word they use for her, conscience for Charlotte, in Charlotte's pursuit of worldly success, recognized greatness, and experience. So it becomes kind of a Bildungsroman for Charlotte, but with her sister playing this peculiar and interesting role.
Yeah, to bring it back to Little Women again, because I think it is correct that Little Women was overlaid on the, in some ways, Emily is kind of Beth, right? Yeah. And in that schematic, then Charlotte becomes Jo.
But a very different kind of Jo.
Yeah, of course. Like, because she's also a lot like Meg.
A Jo that is in danger of losing her soul to the world. And it's interesting that Thackeray is the figure who intervenes here, because he's the most worldly of authors, which is exactly how the two of them get along, but somehow he still has this insight into Wuthering Heights.
I don't know if the real Thackeray did. I don't think we should accept anything at face value, but it'd be interesting to know.
Googling Thackeray and Wuthering Heights, I get absolutely nothing indicating that he championed it.
Or even read it.
Are these even the right dates?
They would have been alive at the same time, but it may all just be fan fiction, yeah.
So apparently Charlotte did go to London after the publication of Jane Eyre. She was celebrated. She was introduced to Thackeray, who was one of her favorite novelists.
But we have no idea what he thought about Wuthering Heights, because that seems to be mostly what he talks about in this movie.
Not based on my very quick Google search. Whether Thackeray was the right person to appreciate Wuthering Heights, that we will all have to find out for ourselves, if there is even any information on it.
All in all, quite a worthwhile mockery of history. I'm really glad we watched it, and especially in contrasting it with our next film, Night and Day.
Well, I'm glad you're saying that, because you are the person who speaks up for all of these travesty American songbook biographies and I was going to ask you how, I mean, I had all the faith in the world in your ingenuity, Dave, but I was going to ask you how you can possibly defend this as a movie.
No, I will not. I love Rhapsody in Blue, the completely made up Gershwin film, but this one is some real dreck.
Absolutely banal.
But let's hear what Clive Hirshhorn has to say. Here's that word again. A travesty of the great Cole Porter's life story and a woebegone tribute to his immortal songs. Night and Day was a wretched musical whose failure to do justice to the dramatic and musical content of its subject was one of the great missed opportunities in the history of the studio, but it was a box office smash nonetheless.
Oh, what were they going to do with the story of Cole Porter's life? But they could have done a better job with the musical numbers.
With the complete Porter catalog at his disposal, Michael Curtiz, abetted by four writers, Jack Moffat, Charles Hoffman, Leo Townsend, and William Bowers, emerged with a garish non-starter in Technicolor. Starting with a monumental miscasting of Cary Grant as Porter,
who, by the way, is very good in this movie. It's like the one thing you can recommend about it.
And Alexis Smith as his wife, Linda Lee, to Leroy Prinz's unimaginative staging of the musical numbers, the film was a catalog of disasters.
Cary Grant hated the writing of this film, apparently.
Only enlivened by Mary Martin's famous rendering of My Heart Belongs to Daddy.
True, that's the one great number in this movie.
And Monty Woolley, playing himself, talk-singing Miss Otis Regrets. For the rest, Jane Wyman, Ginny Sims, and Eve Arden were simply not up to the Porter masterpieces they were called on to interpret. While the scene depicting the creation of the classic Night and Day, complete with the cliché, "Wait a minute, I think I've got it," has to be the most absurd in the history of a generally absurd genre, the musical biopic.
Oh, the absolute literalism of that scene? Are you not embarrassed for Michael Curtiz?
The producer was Arthur Schwartz. Songs included In the Still of the Night, Old Fashioned Garden, Let's Do It, You Do Something to Me, What Is This Thing Called Love, I've Got You Under My Skin, Just One of Those Things, Begin the Begin, You're the Top, I Get a Kick Out of You, and Easy to Love.
What is true in this dreck?
Yale?
Yale. Porter went to Yale. Porter did defy his grandfather's wishes that he become a lawyer. He never, ever struggled financially, nor wished to, ever.
No.
Quite on the contrary, his extravagance would make a multi-millionaire hip-hop artist look humble.
He was friends with Monty Woolley.
It's true that he was friends with Monty Woolley, and they had many gay adventures together, which are not in this film. However, there is one joke allusion to it when he visits Cole Porter in the hospital, right? Flowers, you can't give those to a man unless he's flat on his back, says Monty Woolley. Apparently, Cole Porter did very much love his socialite wife. Who knows if they ever had sex? It is not recounted in the Wikipedia entry, but she knew he was gay and promiscuous and didn't care. Which would make a fascinating film if anybody cared to make that. But there is no struggle. There's just, he was rich, he was talented, he got a bit of a slow start, but then he became very famous. So there's not a lot of drama here, unless, I mean, the drama actually starts where the movie ends. The drama of Cole Porter's life is the terrible accident that he suffered and, you know, how he went on after that.
Right.
But with terrible pain, ongoing related illness that eventually killed him. That actually could make a pretty damn interesting but very depressing movie.
Well, didn't they make a movie a few years ago?
Apparently it's even worse than this one.
Did it actually deal with his accident? Wasn't it Kevin Kline playing him?
I don't know, but apparently it was terrible.
I did not see it. The drama they invent for this film is that he is too obsessed with work and neglects his wife.
And he also lacks the common touch.
Oh, well, that's at the beginning. A gesture that seems to be quickly forgotten because he goes back to writing his usual stuff and everyone loves it. I really enjoy Ginny Sims in this movie, I will say. Those scenes are actually pretty fun. When he, as you say, this seems to be totally fictional when he's told that he has to go spelunking in Tin Pan Alley for the Common Touch, and he spends some time as a song plugger at a typical music store, teamed up with Ginny Sims, who is a great singer for Kay Kaiser's band. She has a crush on him and really puts some moves on him, or tries to. It makes no impact.
It is fascinating. The movie's gestures toward Cole Porter's homosexuality are all in the form of portraying him as asexual, and yet there's this weird disjunction during this whole section where we're meant to believe that his wife is upset that he's got all these showgirls around, although he's showing absolutely no interest in them. Monty Woolley has to totally unbelievably pretend for a moment to be interested, but I mean, this is one of the benefits of having Cary Grant in this role, as miscast as he is. Cary Grant will happily play not being interested in women. He will happily do that. He does not have the vanity of having to look like he's a wolf at every moment in a movie.
So many scenes in this movie are him just standing there while a woman tries to hit on him or kisses him and he doesn't really react. He does have a reaction to Alexis Smith, but that's transient. He doesn't really get it back until after his accident and they have their big reunion at the Yale celebrations.
Even though the general public would have no idea what homosexuality even was, isn't it bizarre that this movie feels some kind of need to incorporate it despite its totally fictitious nature?
No, I don't think that's odd at all. I think to try to communicate some feeble sense of Cole Porter, they probably felt like they had to do that.
Why not just present a completely fictional Cole Porter who is avidly heterosexual? Why not? Like, why go halfway like this and present something so tepid? It's so odd.
The shred of integrity the movie has, right? You have to cling to that. It's not enough to make me like the movie. No. I've never liked this movie.
No. Why did you want to do it?
Well, because I thought what we're trying to do here is pick representative film.
Well, how is this representative of Warner Brothers, this movie?
It's representative of the kind of missteps that could be taken when you jump on this biopic bandwagon.
And why would Warner Brothers do the least proletarian of all the great American songbook composers?
Well, that was just a scramble for rights. Someone else had already signed up. But they did do Gershwin, and that Gershwin biopic is awesome. Rhapsody in Blue, we will talk about it. And I wanted to have this one on the schedule so we could contrast it to Rhapsody in Blue. Because again, they just made up Gershwin's life too, but somehow it all works so beautifully in that movie. It's a great movie about being an artist, and this movie just does not communicate that at all, even though that is ostensibly the problem in his relations with Alexis Smith, that he's too into being an artist or creator or showman.
Right, but because he doesn't have any interest in this circus going on around him, which the real Cole Porter
did.
He absolutely loved having a three-ring circus around him at all times, right? He was enjoying the hell out of himself.
Yeah, that's the problem. Well, one of the many problems with this movie. Cary Grant seems oblivious to all these women, but he seems oblivious to showbiz as well. It all seems like he's being put upon all the time, and his only real interest and goal is to write songs and have them be performed. He's not portrayed as being obsessed with glitz, as
right.
You said.
A bon vivant who loved luxury more than anything, apparently, and was born to it and got more of it.
I can't imagine they made up, although I don't know. I mean, I don't know anything about Cole Porter's life either, really. But was he wounded in World War One?
People aren't even sure whether he was in World War One. Okay. He told some stories about it that may or may not be true, including that he was in the French Foreign Legion.
Okay, well, the movie certainly makes it seem like that's a settled fact.
No.
And I guess I always believed that part of it, because I saw this movie when I was very young.
The French Foreign Legion claims him, apparently, but no one's sure whether his story about that was apocryphal or not.
Well, nobody knows what he was doing for 3 years in the mid-19-teens.
Wikipedia says, some writers have been skeptical about Porter's claim to have served in the French Foreign Legion. But the Legion lists Porter as one of its soldiers and displays his portrait at its museum in Aubagne. I don't know, does that verify? Does that in fact verify that he was there?
Probably he wasn't wounded and nursed back to health by his future wife.
Right, so his wife is actually given something useful to do in this movie. I see nothing of the kind in her brief Wikipedia entry.
In the movie, she follows him to the European Theater of War or North Africa or wherever he is. She's a nurse, and then she just continues on with nursing and caretaking and helps set up a hospital.
Yeah, not seeing anything like that in my Google research here.
Well, I'm not surprised. No, I didn't believe any of that even as a 12-year-old.
Like, they sound like they were living the lives of Charles Foster Kane and Susan Kane, except enjoying themselves.
Right.
Until his accident.
Did they pull together after his accident?
All I read about, well, he definitely didn't stop having boyfriends, because I remember that from a Cole Porter biography I read as a teenager, or I'm not sure if I read the whole thing, but I looked through it. But yes, apparently they had a very devoted marriage. That lasted to her death at the age of 70.
Was she older than Cole Porter?
8 years older?
Yeah, that's not the case in the film. Alexis Smith is clearly quite a bit younger than Cary Grant. Could have done a lot of things differently.
A fascinating movie is yet to be made of this marriage.
You read about Dee Lovely and people do hate it?
Critics despised it, apparently.
Okay. Well,
it was about their marriage, but I don't know what it had to say about their marriage.
Well, it had to say more than this does. I guess we could give it that. I'm gonna assume a little bit more thinking about the actual marriage between those two people.
But we're not, I don't know if we really can assume that. There are a lot of bad movies out there.
Here's a movie where just such criminal misuse, thankless roles for Jane Wyman and Dorothy Malone. It almost makes it worthwhile to me as a Monty Woolley fan to have him in here playing himself as a disreputable professor, although he becomes sort of the voice of conscience at the end.
And but he does have this one-note joke about his beard that starts to get irritating.
He makes several comments about how he thinks nobody should ever get married, and he doesn't care about any marriages, but he's just got to care about this one. Because
it's Linda who's the beard.
That's right.
Well, yeah, I think enough said.
The Mary Martin number is good.
It is good, although the way she's introduced, that we're supposed to believe that this could be anybody's introduction to showbiz, was the insult to the basic intelligence that Crowther thought the Brontë sisters movie was.
Yeah, Jane Wyman is offered a big song and she says, no, I can't sing well enough, but here, let's go into the chorus and get Mary Martin.
Here's this useless hayseed with no experience. But I just know she's a showstopper. Well, let's see. One of the first things she did was open her own dance studio.
No, that doesn't seem to be...
That's in the apprenticeship portion of her Wikipedia page.
I think that does bring to a close our discussion of Warner Brothers 1946. We've got good use of travesty of history, bad use of travesty of history, from my perspective anyway.
I would say terrible use and not completely irredeemable use.
Let's get into Fear and Moviegoing in Toronto, the first phase of the Marguerite Duras retrospective going on right now at TIFF Lightbox.
So it's rare for us to see 5 films without having communicated about them at all. 5 films into a retrospective, but Dave will not let us discuss anything in advance for the podcast.
Well, we have discussed India Song before on this podcast because we saw it last year as part of the Delphine Serie retrospective.
It's been quite an experience, these 5 Duras films. I have no idea where you're at. Where is your head at with Marguerite Duras at this point, I guess, midway through the retrospective?
They're absolute genius, all 5 of them.
Great. Amazing. Awesome. Great. Well, I guess we need to start talking then.
Now, we're not going to go into great detail about these.
Well, we'll go into some detail because our podcast is planned so far in advance that it will be decades. I'd like to do some of these Duras films together with the text because we're always looking for excuses to do that, and we don't have that many readings, literary cinema combo episodes. But that won't happen for decades.
You know, 2040, we'll be ready. So the first film that we saw was Détruire, dit-elle, Destroy, she said, which is also the title of the retrospective overall.
And we should say that the cinematographer of India Song and several of her other films was with us.
Bruno Nuiten. And he was awesome.
He was very fun and really gave a sense of what many people who knew Duras have commented on, of her being some kind of an endlessly enchanting personality up to the end of her life. Like an agelessly enchanting personality.
He did encourage us to think of her as two different people at least. He said there's Duras, the solemn writer. That's how he put it. And then there was Marguerite, which is the person he knew, who liked to have fun making movies. Although these movies are
pretty heavy.
Far from lightweight. But they were having a great deal of fun making them. That's what he stressed.
Right, because they were very exploratory.
Yeah.
Informal and low budget, so they had to be inventive. So the India Song version that we saw was restored by him, and it looked absolutely stunning.
It was quite an upgrade from the 35mm print that we saw last year that was quite frayed.
And because these are very rare screenings, we were told that this is the largest Duras retrospective to occur in North America. There's going to be a larger one coming up in France. Because these are very rare screenings in some case, and we had to be coddled with, well, Dave didn't, but much of the audience had to be coddled with English subtitles. So far, India Song is the only restored version we've seen, so it made it striking contrast with the other, you know, the state of the other films. And with India Song as we saw it before. Let's start with India Song because we've seen it before so we can be brief. I would say that the first time we watched it, I liked it, but it seemed very, very challenging and alien. But I already feel like with the second viewing, particularly with this restored viewing that made its beauty so evident, I feel like I this is going to sound wrong. It's not fully what I mean. I feel like I got it. Now, I don't mean that I fully got everything that was to be understood about the film, which probably you never could, no matter how often you viewed it. The films are very mysterious, as Bruno kept saying, but I feel like I understood what it was doing.
So how would you describe what it is doing?
Well, first of all, it is juxtaposing text, a poetic text, a poem, which is presented as two voices in a sort of dialogue, although dialogue is not exactly how to describe it. One voice likes to just say yes a lot.
Well, it feels kind of call and response to some extent.
Sure. So musical as well. And then other voices of the characters float in and out of that, of the narrative voice. Juxtaposing this poetic text in sort of dialogue form or choral form with images that don't exactly match. Well, in some cases don't at all match because the voices are talking about something that happened a long time ago, but then sometimes switch to the present of these characters who experience those events. It's not only juxtaposing those things, which are also juxtaposed to these recurrent musical motifs.
And some of the things they're talking about are visuals from other movies that are connected to it, right? Like they talk about La Bicyclette d'Anne-Marie Strether, and we finally saw it in La Femme du Gange.
No, I think we see it in India Song too.
Really?
I think we do. But we see it again in La Femme du Gange, which was made a year earlier. But then also, we're supposed to be in India, and we're not. Not at all. And there's no attempt to make you believe visually that we're in India. So that's another juxtaposition. And also there's the political intent of the film, which I thought was present on a first viewing. But I understood more about what it was doing on a second viewing, and did have that confirmed by reading about Duras and things that she'd said about the film as well. It became evident to me after watching the first two movies in this series, Destroy, She Said, and India Song, that's the order in which they were presented, pretty much guessed that Duras was a communist, and that was true. She left the Communist Party at an early point, well, from the little bit of reading I've done, because it was intellectually obtuse and petty and stupid.
No, she wasn't happy with Stalin, I imagine.
No, she was just mad about the Communist Party, like the people in it, being annoying, not very smart about art.
Right, but the Communist Party was, at that point, in the mid-20th century, taking instructions from Stalin.
I mean, clearly what she's doing is not social realism.
No.
And she hated that. She hated the typical political film. And already you can see her struggling with the issue in her screenplay for Elaine René's Hiroshima Mon Amour, the question of how to represent suffering after the Holocaust, right? And so there's this invisible world of suffering that is the world of the poor in India that is constantly alluded to.
La mendiante de Laos. So a woman who made the trek from Laos to wherever they are in India. It's not even a real place in India. I mean, it's an embassy, a European embassy. The soundtrack does contain this sonic evidence of these people that are never shown.
Well, I mean, there's her. There's that beggar woman. But there's also constant allusions to the hunger and the leprosy the population, and these become motifs and themes within the poem. Ultimately, what we see in that final juxtaposition of the wealthy colonists and the poverty of the nation is that the more sensitive members among the colonists, they're not necessarily nice people or pleasant people, but they are sensitive people, mainly Anne-Marie Stretter, the heroine, played by Delphine Seyrig, and the male virgin of Lahore,
Le Vice-Consul,
played by Michael Lonsdale, who, according to him, are one and the same person. They are destroyed. They are destroyed by this inescapable knowledge, this inescapable evil of the colonial West.
Yeah, well, they're not only destroyed by it. Certainly Michael Lonsdale, from what I gather, he's a disgraced vice consul. Why is he disgraced? Because he went out into the streets of Lahore and just shot lepers.
Yeah, exactly. So he didn't react
fucking maniac.
He is a maniac, but he didn't react to this knowledge of evil in a nice way. He didn't become a Marxist or an activist on behalf of the poor.
But you're right, he didn't just act as if it's not there.
Exactly. And he didn't become comfortable with it. They keep talking about how they hate the people who get used to India. And over and over again, that refrain, I don't know what it is in French, but in the English subtitles, India, can't bear it. Can't bear it at all.
Ne supporte pas.
Ne supporte pas. Yeah, so they're like externalized and internalized versions of each other, as he tells her in his monologue before he goes incel crazy.
Well, he was already crazy.
But he goes crazy again. He is what we would now call an incel, taking it out on the lepers and taking it out on this idealized woman who, because she's out of his league and he can't have her, he doesn't want anyone and he doesn't want to live or for her to live.
And he wants to drag her into a public scandal, he says. Un incident public. And he certainly makes one. That was, I think, the centerpiece of our discussion last time. This weird, meditative, incantatory film with...
Where you actually do an intent... It's clear after seeing several of her films. It's intentional that you might fall asleep at moments during this film, because everybody needs to sleep at some point in her films. There's, like, always a sleeper.
It's ASMR, whispering voices. It's the kind of thing that you put on to try to help you to fall asleep. And then he threatens to, and then goes ahead and does, overturn all of that with 15-20 minutes of shrieking.
Yeah,
in the streets.
It's this total gender reversal. Like, for example, I used to put on Inland Empire late at night, you know, for atmosphere, and then I would fall asleep during it. As you do with a horror movie, you fall asleep during it, and it's quiet for a long, 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 long time. And then suddenly a woman is screaming and you wake up and you're, you know, startled, and maybe it gets incorporated into your nightmare. Well, it's a man in this movie.
At first, he's yelling a bunch of things about how he wants to stay at the embassy overnight.
And just one time with her. Avec elle, avec elle, une fois.
After that, he just starts yelling her name over and over again. Not her current name, but the name that she had when she lived in Venice. Her Venetian name, Anna Maria Gaudi. And it just goes on and on.
And then they make their little comments. Then they go to the islands, and there's this ridiculous, decadent, dissipated tableau out of a Vogue photo shoot, right? And then disembodied voices, because all of the dialogue was recorded afterwards, and nobody's mouth is moving during the entire film.
No.
So these disembodied voices are all of a sudden like, is that the vice consul screaming again?
It's the vice consul of France who's yelling. That's what someone says near the end of the party before they go to the island. We may have talked about this at one point, or we may not have, but I feel like you gotta discern a little bit of a sacred fount.
Oh, yes. Like, a lot, watching these movies, a lot of feelings of the occult or weirder side of Henry James. A lot of feelings of David Lynch, particularly in... Oh, what would you say particularly in? Did you have the feeling of David Lynch at any point?
La Femme du Gange, especially. Yeah,
absolutely. Like, low budget. Well, David Lynch is low budget, but more utilitarian David Lynch. More austere and theater-based, right? Rather than David Lynch being more of a visual artist.
Right. But just a lot of people trying to figure out who the other people are, what they've done, what was motivating them. And no clear answers, and very hard to tell.
So we switch over to talking about La Femme du Gange.
That's also India song. I mean, there's a lot of people talking, and we're never told. And these are considered to be an informal trilogy by some. That's La Femme du Gange, India song, Son Nom de Venise.
So let's talk about, before we go back to La Femme du Gange, which for me relates to Destroy, She Said. Let's quickly talk about Son Nom de Venise dans Calcutta Désert.
So her Venetian name in deserted Calcutta.
This film, and I don't know, if you didn't know that this was the case, I don't know how you would react to this film. You have to know what this place is that they're exploring in order to understand it, I think.
Yeah, and thankfully we had Bruno Nooten there to tell us about the adventure that they had going underground and emerging within the rotting Chateau Rothschild.
So the Chateau Rothschild was used for the exteriors for India's song. So it's this mysterious, haunted-looking mansion, this Wuthering Heights, and then Duras decided she wanted to go back and explore the interior of it.
Well, she had to be pressured to do so, because it sounds like her cinematographer, Bruno Nooten, discovered this passage into it with a couple of other technical people working on the film, and they mentioned it to her, and she's like, no, I'm never going in there. And then
she said that about the underground kitchen, which confirmed, I don't know what order of events this was in, but that confirmed for them that this place had been occupied by the Nazis, and that's why the Rothschilds abandoned it. But I guess much later, Bruno Nooten must have learned more, because he told the audience that Goering had set up headquarters there.
At least for part of the time, yeah.
Yeah. But I don't know if they knew that. I don't think they didn't seem to know that at the point at which they explored it.
No.
So they went back and explored the grounds and the building and this creepy as fuck underground kitchen. Although, as he pointed out, interestingly, she refused to film the American and German writing on the walls of the occupiers. Her husband, at the time of the German occupation of France, was sent to a concentration camp and came back barely alive.
Hmm.
She worked for the Vichy government and later became involved in the resistance.
Couldn't bear it for long.
No.
The Vichy government.
Right. So one or the other of them, her and the cinematographer, were pushing each other around in a wheelchair and holding the camera to get these visuals.
And then they just put the same soundtrack, the same music and dialogue from India Song over this documentary exploration of the Chateau Rothschild. And that's the film.
Now, we haven't yet given a shout-out to the programmer here, although I think we've mentioned her before. Andrea Picard has been responsible for, in recent years, ever since the Chantal Ackerman retrospective, some of our greatest experiences at TIFF.
Yeah, well, she brought the Angela Shanaluk movies to TIFF. She brought the Marta Mazaros movies.
Was she the Mazaros programmer?
Yeah.
Yeah, so she's finding all of these female avant-garde filmmakers who are really pushing R, and I'm sure the rest of the Cinematheque audience's boundaries in terms of openness to avant-garde filmmaking. Nevertheless, they are also all very emotional filmmakers who still do have characters who are in relationships. It's not entirely experimental filmmaking.
No.
It's accessible. It's pushing our boundaries, but it is still the accessible avant-garde, I would say.
Well, it's not abstract. It's still figurative, to use al plastique terms.
So, Andrea Picard, I think she was the one who emphasized that one of the things that Duras is doing in her cinema is finding ways... Yeah, it was her. Finding ways to make you focus on her text in a particular way that would not be satisfied by a radio play, for example. And it's hard to understand in the abstract how cinema could be used to do that, but I totally got it watching Son Nom de Venise, because on the one hand, the atmosphere of this deserted, decaying chateau haunted by history, and the visual beauty of the decayed grandeur.
It must even help you to focus on the text when you're using subtitles to understand what's being said.
Oh, yeah. Oh, no, no. It really did help. I don't know. You have to tell me what your experience of it was not using the subtitles. But so watching this exploration that's kind of boring and fascinating, boring and suspenseful at the same time, and also visually fascinating just because of what it is. Decay does have this kind of beauty to it. But at the same time, being able to listen again, because this was right after India Song, this was the next one that was programmed, being able to listen again to that difficult text, difficult because it's a whole novel condensed into very abbreviated lines and...
Party chatter.
Party chatter and gossip, and also it jumps around in time throughout the whole thing and then alludes to events that we've never heard of before all of a sudden that come before the events that we have heard about. So it just gave me another chance to basically comprehend what they were talking about more. But, you know, I would need many other viewings to catch, or listenings, auditings, to catch more of it.
At the end of his introduction to Son Nom de Venise, Bruno Nuitin was like, if you didn't watch India Song last night or you've never seen it, I don't understand what you're going to get out of this.
If you want to sleep or you want to leave, that's fine.
I won't be offended, he said.
No one did, but there were a lot of walkouts on La Femme du Gange.
Yeah.
I don't think I've ever seen that many walkouts at TIFF before.
Which is weird. Yeah, I don't know.
I was like, why this one? Why is this one your limit? Or did you not go to the other ones? Or
I guess not.
India Song was shown in the larger cinema and it was practically full.
It's a famous movie. As famous as her movies get, I think. Yeah. Other than Hiroshima Mon Amour, which she wrote.
So yeah, tell me, what was your experience of Son Nom de Venise without the subtitles?
Well, it was similar to you, right? It did give me another chance to reflect on what was really being said in India Song and how it all fits together, or how I conceive it to fit together. Who are these people speaking? You're trying to isolate the voices. I mean, some of it's clear. You know it's Michael Lonsdale speaking. You know it's Delphine Seyrig. But the women at the beginning were talking to each other about la mendiante, the beggar woman, and the setting the scene for the events at the embassy. You know, who are they?
They could be anyone. Like, some have suggested, are they servants gossiping about this? Well, maybe. Or maybe they're spirits from another world. And whenever she's saying, yes, yes, I remember, it seems less like she's referring to a, like, this is, by she, I mean one of the voices. Less like she's referring to events that she heard about that she's forgotten about than it's like a platonic memory of something you always knew that you're recovering.
There is a lot about memory and forgetting in the trilogy. Well, one of the actresses who is doing the voice is Nicole Hiss.
This voice is so strange. And the tone that she adopts is so strange. It's weird and childlike.
Yeah. She's a really interesting actress. I mean, she has a role, a big role on screen in Die Twill-Detail, playing Alyssa. You know, I took note of her in that one. It seems like she didn't do anything other than a few movies for Marguerite Duras, mostly voiceover like this. But she's also in La Femme du Gange, playing maybe Lola?
Lola Valerie Stein? Names have this materiality for her. That was another thing I was going to say about India Song. That I didn't understand the first time I watched it, or wasn't sure about. These colonists, she's well aware that they are implicated, these wealthy colonists. She's a fucking Marxist, Duras. She's well aware that they are implicated in the suffering of the impoverished people around them, but their ridiculous love tragedies are taken with the most absolute seriousness by her regardless. She is obsessed with these characters and the variations on them that recur in all of the media that she works in.
Yeah, that's true. She's holding both of those things together and apart in a way. Like, they both have tragic power for her.
They're interrelated even by right. her.
Well, yeah, the horrors of the material exploitation are gnawing away at the souls of these people who are also having tragic inability to relate to each other or make each other happy in any way, despite the luxury in which they live.
A luxury that's barely suggested by just a few mirrors, tableaus, and a red gown.
Well, yeah, but it does seem pretty sumptuous somehow in India Song.
I'll just talk briefly. I keep saying I'm going to be brief and then I'm not. But let me give my brief impression on the relatedness of La Femme du Gange and Die Twill-Detail. In La Femme du Gange, there are a whole bunch of characters. Okay, well, there's Michael Curtiz, whose name, again, gets obsessively repeated over and over in both India Song and this movie. So he's the central character who's gone back to this site of love tragedy. There's been many love tragedies in his life, or anyway, two very important ones, one causing the other. And he goes back to this site of memory, this hotel on the beach.
Which, again, is supposed to be in India?
Again, yeah.
Or I don't know if it's supposed to be in India, but they talk about India and the Ganges, but
Estella.
Yeah, Estella is a fictional place.
Yeah, I think it is supposed to be in India,
it
yes.
It looks like Europe.
It's yeah. not at all. And he just endlessly wanders these corridors and encounters these weirdo characters who seem like they're doing theater exercises.
They do seem a little bit like Céline et Judy vont au bateau.
This is the most Rivette-like of her movies that I've seen so far. Gradually, we come to understand, maybe too clearly for a Duras movie, that they are spirits, but there is still much, much to not understand.
They're spirits with a caretaker, a very simple-minded caretaker played by Gérald Depardieu,
who keeps getting lost and whose spirits that he's looking after think he's crazy, and he agrees.
Yeah.
Yes, I'm crazy.
She gets so much fun out of Gérald Depardieu in her films. We'll be watching Nathalie Granger in a week and a half or so. That one we did see a few years ago, and Depardieu has an amazing vignette as a washing machine salesman.
He's always very naive and ingenue-like and befuddled.
And that's a huge part of Le Camion, another totally unexpected film. Bruno Nuitin was there to introduce that one, where he talks about, great, I've always wanted to do a road movie. Marguerite Duras, an aging woman, gets on a truck and has like a long discussion, like shades of the beginning of Je tue il elle.
Yeah, she had to have been inspired by that.
So instead of a young girl gets on a truck and talks to a camionneur, it's, 60-year-old Marguerite Duras. Except that it was too cold, and she's like, okay, no, forget it, we're going inside. And
but of course, this is just more of her idealism, right?
Yeah.
So she's going to sit at a table with Gérard Depardieu and read a script that she was making up as she went along, Inland Empire style, apparently, as they were filming the movie. And this is going to be, well, she's going to ask us to imagine a movie in which all of this takes place. So again, so she's getting us to focus on the text that she's reading, but at the same time, the movie is our visualization of the movie.
Yeah.
Which was not appreciated at Cannes, apparently.
No.
So this is an anti-cinema gesture, this movie, right?
It seems to be.
And furthermore, even this dialogue at the table, you know, shades of what she's doing with the narrators in India Song, is mostly a monologue. It's meta within the text she's reading, that despite the fact that it's her monologue of this quasi-autobiographical monologue, philosophical, but very fuzzy philosophical ideas, not in any way precise, of this 60-year-old woman.
Who may have escaped from the lunatic asylum.
Right. Despite the fact that it's 98% her talking, him being there as a presence, listening, affirming, or calling her on her bullshit is absolutely necessary.
Of course. And she's, you know, winking at him and flirting with him the whole time as well, all the while discussing the fact that, well, the trucker pays no attention to women who are of a certain age. By extension, she's talking about Depeltier too, and any young man would ignore a 60-year-old woman.
Apparently this was not true of Marguerite Duras. She was not ignored at any age.
Right. Well, she may have had compensating virtues that allowed her to capture the interest of... But anyway, she's making a comment on society that in general, yes, this is something that you can observe, that men would tend to just act as if a 60-year-old woman is not there. And she's insisting upon the fact that she is there, and she is going to dominate the entire conversation.
I had meant to get back to Destroy She Said, though, talk about the spirits, because this movie, which shares several motifs with India Song, well, the diabolical tennis court.
Oh, that's everywhere.
That's everywhere. Also a diabolical forest. It starts with a group of characters that ultimately form a menage a trois, but are also kind of interchangeable, particularly the two men, Stein and Max Thor. Ridiculous names. Well, Max Thor is a ridiculous name. Stein is just one of her favorite names. Stein declares himself a Jew, to start out with. Later on, everybody in this group becomes a German Jew, and that becomes important. They are all outsiders, and part of the way through the film, the point of view character seems to become Elizabeth, played by Catherine Sellers, who is this bourgeois woman, and these other three grow increasingly mysterious and seem to be, after some fashion, persecuting her, and the relationship between them and her at times feels sinister and demonic, and yet they also seem to be heroic characters. It's all very ambiguous how we are supposed to feel about anything that's going on, and in the sense that they don't seem quite human, perhaps. That's the way that I relate it to La Femme du Gange, but it's much less clear who anybody is and how they all relate to each other in this movie. Like, I found that richer in this movie.
Yeah, it was amazing.
But the points at which, like, the work that she does with actors here and how a banal conversation will just imperceptibly turn completely sinister, that's what I found fascinating. Without knowing why.
It's these two men who seem to be hanging out at a spa for the rest cure, or an asylum, or not exactly sure.
It's a sanatorium.
They are thinking and musing on the daily activities of this woman, Catherine Sellers, and she seems really enigmatic at first. And it seems like, okay, these are the
normal people.
Right. And she's, you know, possibly sinister, possibly angelic or persecuted or whatever, but she seems totally like outside of our purview. And then, as you say, she becomes the person who's at the center of the story. Along the way, Max Thor gets his wife to show up, which is Alyssa, and she is just as strangely accessible and demonic as the other two guys. They all seem to have an unhealthy fixation on Elizabeth. And yeah, Elizabeth is sort of surrounded by these people that are trying to get her to do things that, I don't know, maybe they're for her own good or maybe they're for her destruction.
Or both.
Yeah, and meanwhile,
I mean, she is on one level, she is the bourgeoisie that must be destroyed. That is possibly the only thing I understand about the movie.
And she, intelligently, I would say, decides for her own survival, she should get her husband over here. She needs someone that may be a little bit closer to being on her side.
But when he arrives, she seems as much aligned with them, like she's become infected by whatever's going on with them, him.
Oh, yeah.
As she does with him, and he becomes the outsider to this strange, enigmatic group.
Yeah, did you recognize Daniel Jalin? He's a huge star of 40s and 50s French cinema. We've seen him in lots of stuff. You know, he's in Edouard Caroline and La Ronde. He's like, what the fuck has been going on here? I thought this was supposed to make my wife better, and she's gotten even weirder. Now I'm supposed to take her home with me like this? That conversation is hilarious. And then things just get unbearably sinister as the movie
Oh, what about the... concludes. Speaking of sinister, I'm suddenly being reminded of... What about the demon children in La Femme du Gange who just show up with the fire alarm that keeps... Or the siren, the fire truck siren that just keeps going off.
Yeah, that makes me think of Inland Empire and that conflagration that happens in there with the fire consuming everything.
She really likes, like Lynch, she really likes fire as a symbol, although we don't ever see fire. Bruno had questions for the audience about what was going on in India Song.
Yeah.
Why is this picture that's on the piano the whole time, why is it not a picture of Delphine Seyrig? Is it Lil Valerie Stein? Mind-blowing if so. Because that, you know, completely changes everything that we think is going on in the movie.
That's the woman that he left for Delphine Seyrig and who killed herself.
Right. Who's a spirit in La Femme du Gange who has to sleep or she will die, even though she's already dead.
Well, let's stop there. We'll revisit these movies and we'll do a lot more reading about them. We'll pair them up with Le Vice-Consul and some other writings of Marguerite Duras. We'll have startling insights for you in 2040, I'm sure.
Well, but we still have also the rest of this retrospective.
Yes.
Was there anything else you wanted to say about Le Camion, the least sinister and Lynchian and Rivettian of the films that we saw?
Well, except the whole movie is her saying that the world has gone to hell.
True. I mean, it was more disillusioned leftism, you know, comparable to the Baldwin documentary that we were talking about, or the Baldwin documentaries, although that was focused on the civil rights area. This was particularly focused on the failures of 20th century communism and...
She's like, Karl Marx, c'est fini ça.
Several times she said that. She obviously went through the entire trajectory of leftists who lived through that period of really believing that a proletariat revolution was going to occur.
Yeah, well, it didn't happen, unfortunately. And it probably won't happen before next week, but we will be here.
Well, we hope.
We intend to be here with Lily Palmer, part 12, we'll be discussing But Not For Me. This has always been a low-key favorite of mine from the late 50s. And Conspiracy of Hearts. Don't really know what that is, but I'm sure we're going to have a lot to say about it 7 days from now. See you then.